On this episode of Co-op Conversations, I am talking to our good buddy Mitch Hallock, who is the man behind Big Fedora Marketing and is the organizer of TerrifiCon and the upcoming Connecticut GamerCon. Hey everybody, it's Brian from Co-op Critics, and this is another of our Co-op Conversations, which is a series of interviews and long-form discussions with creators, with gamers, with YouTube personalities. And today, as you're going to hear in a minute, I am talking to someone that I've known for a very long time. Anybody who has followed my work outside of Co-op Critics knows that I have been co-hosting the Secret Identity podcast for 11 years now, just about, with my good friend Matt Herring. Now, our buddy Mitch Hallock is a convention organizer and promoter, and he is the man behind TerrifiCon, which is a fantastic comic book convention that happens every summer at the Mohegan Sun. Well, this year, on April 1st and 2nd, they are going to be having the very first Connecticut GamerCon, and in this upcoming conversation that you're going to hear, Mitch and I talk about how he got into the convention organizing business, sort of what his motivations were, what the process has been like. We talk a lot about TerrifiCon and what he's built through that show there, and then we talk about this first year of Connecticut GamerCon and what it means for the area and what he's hoping to do with this first year of the show. And it's a great conversation, so if you want a little insight into the behind the scenes of running a convention of any type, you're going to get that in this episode. So I'm going to get out of the way of that right now and let you listen to the conversation that I have with Mitch Hallock. You can go to coopcritics.com for more gaming interviews, news, reviews, and plenty of Let's Play videos that Nick and I do. And if you're interested in the comic book side of things, you can go to secretidentitypodcast.com and learn more about the comic book podcast and the other fun stuff that I do on that side. So big thanks to Mitch. You'll find links in the show notes for this episode to both TerrifiCon and to Connecticut GamerCon. And as we mentioned in this conversation that you'll hear, there are registrations going on right now for some of the fighting game tournaments. So you can check all of that stuff out, and we'll be back again soon with another Co-op Conversations. But without further ado, here is my conversation with Mitch Hallock. Alrighty, this is Brian here with a longtime friend who is embarking on a new adventure. If you listen to Secret Identity at all, then you know that Matt and I frequently talk about our good buddy Mitch Hallock, who is the man behind Big Fedora Marketing, who is the man behind TerrifiCon, and who is now the man behind Connecticut GamerCon. So how are you today, sir?
I am full of energy like a Donkey Kong on Monster Drink right now.
Yep, 8:30 in the morning on a Saturday, and we're talking about your newest venture, which, you know, when we frequently talk about TerrifiCon on Secret Identity. So yep. People kind of know, I think most of our listeners know sort of the origin story of that. But you have this wonderful comic convention that is well established now at Mohegan Sun. It's one of the most, I think, talked about conventions in the New England area. And this year in April, on April 1st and 2nd, you are now going to be starting a gaming convention in the area. So, we'll kind of talk about the nuts and bolts of Connecticut GamerCon in a minute, but Can you just talk a little bit about, A, how you got into promoting for shows, and then how sort of TerrifiCon led to GamerCon?
Well, I'm old now, so I'm 50, but ever since the very first comic book, I remember you'd see these ads, and you're a little younger than me, but in the 70s, there would be ads for Marvel Comics had their own comic conventions, and they were in New York, and they were called like the Mary Marvel. I can't remember what the real name was, but of all things, it was in the middle of the week. It was on a Wednesday, Thursday, and a Friday. It wasn't a Saturday, Sunday, and it was at the Commodore Hotel, and I would see ads for it. It had to be 1974 and 75, and that's like being a kid and seeing the commercials about Disney World. It's like this heaven on earth that you can only hear legends about. Like, oh my God, wouldn't it be amazing to do that, to go there?
Right, this wonderland of hanging out with other people who enjoy comics as well.
Yeah, imagine that, the thought of it. Like, oh my God, there's a whole room of people talking about comic books, and the people that make them are there.
Yep.
And you start to tremble at the thought. But New York, when you're a kid, that's like, might as well be the moon, because you can't just take off and go there.
Well, and there's a Disney World-like quality to New York to begin with, if you live in the New England area, where it's like this fantasy land, and the first time you go there, it is like that, because it's so it's such a different world than, you know, Springfield, Massachusetts, where I am, or, you know, Connecticut, where you are.
Yeah, but I never got to go to that con, and then the actual first con I ever went to in my life, my mom took me on a train. We went to Hartford, the old Hartford Civic Center that fell apart when the roof collapsed. Before that collapsed, actually, we went to a Star Trek convention because I'm a huge Star Trek fan, and Gene Roddenberry was there. And that, I don't even know how many people were there, but it seemed to me like the biggest thing I'd ever gone to. And I met Gene Roddenberry, and we saw the stuff, and the whole place was people wearing Star Trek uniforms and selling. At the time, they didn't have a lot of merchandise, so you would just have like glossy photographs and some books. And maybe some models, and maybe there was no toys or action figures besides Mingo. But the whole con experience just like ingrained and burned itself into my brain. I'm like, this is really an amazing event to get anybody who's interested in something like you said that you're into, and you're all there in mass, and it's okay to talk about it. You know, you're not in the back of the classroom, you're not in the playground just whispering about, hey, did you see this or did you hear about this?
Right.
There's thousands of people like-minded just like you, and they're loving it, and the passion's just exuding through their pores. So it's almost like being on a rock concert. You know how you get everybody at a rock concert, and you're all fans of whatever band's playing that night, so you all have a commonality?
I wholeheartedly agree with that, because I'm a huge concert goer and a huge, you know, metalhead, and that's it's a very similar experience in terms of the excitement that you feel when you get together with a group of people that love something as much as you do, and you can just talk about it. And that's actually the reason why you're there. It feels like the most awesome thing in the world.
Yeah, no, and look how it's shoot off of that, just to go on a tangent. Like the podcasting, the same thing. When I see you and Matt, we just like little kids, like no matter how old we are, we all start going, hey, guess what? Did you get this? Especially Maddie. I mean, you guys just get crazy about stuff because we're so passionate about it. And the moment you can go from your civilian life to your secret identity, little plug there.
Yes, that was nice. Talk, I like how you did that.
Thank you. And you can talk about the thing you really love. You know, your hands start to move around and your eyes light up. And I remember I would be at work years ago, and my CEO would come by. He goes, I could always tell when Mitch is talking about comic books or movies, because from a distance you could see his hands are flying and he's energetic and he's jumping around. Talk about work, and he's normal, but talk about something he loves. And he's just like a jumping bean. He can't sit still. So that's what it comes to the conventions. That energy, it just wakes you up. Talking about it with you right now, I'm all pumped, right? Like, let's go to a con right now, Bri. I'll be up there in an hour. And you just love that. So I got into this almost as a kid. I remember going to my first comic cons. I met Wally Wood in the early 1980, I think it was, and he was like a legend. And then Stan Lee and all those experiences, you just can't believe that these are the gods that you read about. You know, these are the people that make Spider-Man, these are the people that make Batman, and there they are, just normal guys, but they just seem like they're on a level that you'd never thought you'd be in the room with, you know.
And you're a longtime podcaster as well, and,
yes,
and you know, obviously I've been doing this for a long time too, and I think one of the reasons that we got into podcasting is that there's a certain element of our fandom in our own minds as people like you and I that really are fascinated by sort of how they make the donuts, right?
And so I've watched that show, how things are made. That's one of my favorite shows.
It's like that, right? And so growing up, like, you know, I'm sure you were just like I am. The DVD commentary, the director's commentary, behind the scenes, the making of, like that.
The making
was
of, yeah.
So that's one of the whole reasons that we started doing, you know, the Secret Identity podcast. It's one of the reasons I got into covering games and, you know, for CBR for years, because I love to talk to the people that make stuff. And the idea that you can go to these shows and you can actually spend time one-on-one with these people who make the things that have impacted your life in many ways. You know, for a lot of us, comic books were an escape from a lot of other stuff. For me, it was comic books and it was Dungeons and Dragons that was a big escape for me for, you know, for the fact that I was a chubby Catholic school kid that got bullied when I was little, you know, and so to be able to talk to the people who made this stuff is kind of amazing. And that to me was one of the coolest things about the con experience is that you're not only hanging out with other fans of the same things that you love, but you're also talking to the people that made these things that mean so much to you. And that the combination of those two things for me is what makes me love going to those conventions. And I think what we've seen, even in the lifespan of Secret Identity, which again is a little coming up on 11 years, is that when I first started going to shows with Matt in the mid-2000s, we still had those smaller sort of, comic book-focused, very, genre-centric type of shows where you would go to Penn Plaza Pavilion for Big Apple Con, or you would go, you know, to Boston Comic Con in a couple of rooms of a hotel, or Mocha is another great example of that. And you would go to those, and it was very much geared toward comic books, and it was very much geared toward being accessible and affordable and having creators that you could really spend time with. As we've sort of seen, you know, the sort of wizard model took off in the late 2000s, and that really became the template for what New York Comic Con would become, certainly what San Diego has become at this point, and what a lot of these fan expos across the country have become, which is much more of a multimedia, multi-genre sort of play to all fields kind
like
of show.
Like a mall.
Like a mall, and it's become not only less accessible, but much more expensive for your con goer to go to. And we've lost a lot of that. And I know, just knowing you as a friend, that one of the reasons that TerrifiCon has become what it is because you were making a conscious effort to get back to the type of show that we grew up going to and the type of show that we we think of when we think of a fan convention.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. When I talked about going to those shows when I was a younger kid, it wasn't just meeting Wally Wood or Stan Lee or something. It was coming home with stacks of comic books. I mean, I remember saving my allowances, cutting lawns, doing whatever I could do to save up money because there was going to be a Comic Con at a hotel in, like, you know, April. And you would save your money up and you would go to town. I'd come in with a list of the books that I needed to complete a series or fill the gaps in my run or something like that. And I would just go to town looking at every table, hustling with people, trying to make a deal on comics. And it was so exciting to go home. It was like Christmas. You got to pick your own presents and you'd come home with all these books. But it was only like $1 to get in, you know? And it was like a guy at a cigar box at the front door and you pay him a buck and you'd walk around and you could have stayed there all day. But that... You said, yeah, that novelty has gone away. You know, it's almost like the garage band. You know, you see your favorite band down the street and you go to see them in all their local gigs and then they become famous. But now the ticket went from $4 cover to $150 or $300. And you're like, wait, I just want to hear the music. I just want to go back and recapture that experience without selling my house to buy a ticket.
As someone who just spent $300 on Metallica tickets for Gillette Stadium, yes, I can tell you that rings totally true to me, because that is, you know, that's the same for the shows I used to go to. But you're absolutely right. And the thing is about, like, and we know, and you know, obviously through being a promoter and your podcasting stuff, that so many of the artists that come to exhibit at shows, so many of the creators that come to exhibit at shows really depend on the consumers that are coming through the door, visiting their table, buying some stuff, maybe getting a commission, that kind of stuff. And with how expensive a lot of these shows have become, a lot of patrons are walking through the front door with less money in their pocket, which translates to less money spent on creators, which you know, makes it more difficult for creators to make back the money that they spend on their table. And it's this vicious cycle where, in some cases, a lot of creators have been sort of priced out of exhibiting at shows because it's simply not financially feasible for them to come to a show anymore and make their money back and make a little bit of profit, whereas that used to be their lifeblood. They would go to shows and do commissions and sell their own books at their table. and make a pretty good dime. But nowadays, when you're paying $100 for a celebrity photo op, these VIP ticket packages that get up into the hundreds and hundreds of dollars, you know, families go in for that, and then they have no money left for anything else.
Absolutely. That's what I was thinking about when we did this is when I came to producing a show, I said, listen, you know, I love – these are my rock stars. These are my idols. These are my Bruce Springsteens, your Mike Zecks, your Jerry Ordways, your Chris Giarrusso's. He's more of the young YouTube kind of startup guy.
So right, right. He's a younger kid. He's the punk but rock star.
He's the punk rock. He's our Sid Vicious. He'd be like, what? Sid Vicious? So but that's the thing. I've never forgotten that because, look, when I was a kid, I could draw a little bit, and I wanted to grow up to be John Romita Sr., and that's what my did. My whole day was about. I'd come home and draw for hours. So like you said, when you thought about going to these shows to meet the people that make the books, imagine being a little chubby Catholic school kid who had a little bit of a talent and thinking, oh, my God, I can actually make this a career.
Right.
So I was geared towards that. So I would go to these shows, and I wanted to meet them because I wanted to learn the tools of the trade to get a career in this. I remember Mike Zeck calling me up because he lived in New Haven, and my mom would talk to him at the comic book shop. And she's like, oh, my son doesn't know what to do. He's in high school. You know, could you give him some pointers? And then one night the phone rings, and it's Mike Zeck on the phone. And he's talking to me about what schools to go to and what to learn and what to practice. And I love that experience, that one-on-one. So to your point, when you do these shows, it's not only meeting the artists and trying to buy their book or sketch, but the intimacy of actually going up to a creator and sitting there and talking to them as they sketch and actually getting an insight to their world is also part of the experience that you don't get anymore, because a lot of the big shows – it's like you wait in line and then you wait in another line. I call it like, it's like going to Disney World without going on the rides.
Yep.
You just pay your money. You stand in lines for hours. You get maybe 5 seconds of, you know, some entertainment, and then you go on to the next line and you do it all over again. And I go, this is not a convention. There's no community here. This is, I don't know what this is really. I don't know what it's evolved into, but I don't really like it. You know what I mean? I don't like that experience anymore. And then it turns you off because the guy behind the table, what I've heard the celebrities and the artists call them, they call them belt buckle cons.
Right.
Because they're sitting down and all they'll ever do is get to look up for a second and they'll see, you know, right around your gut area, your belt buckle, and then you're gone. And then the next right. belt buckle's there because they don't have time to engage with you because the sick business of it is the bigger the celebrity, the bigger the guarantee or the money that they need to make to justify their appearance. These people just don't show up there. It is a business. And I found out how they make the sausage now, so I don't eat as many hot dogs as I used to.
Right.
So when you're on the other side of the table, you find out, well, this guy's got to make $30,000 this weekend because, you know, the promoter is invested in that. So that's why they're pushing you along the line, like next, 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 because they're trying to make money. And it just takes so much away from it. It would be like going to your $300 Metallica concert and finding out that they are just lip syncing. And you're like, hey, come on, I paid good money for this. Where's the show? You know?
You hit on something that I think is so important and is such a big reason of why we see shows sort of operate the way that they do today. And I think a lot of people don't necessarily realize that. And you know, when we talked about sort of the smaller and mid-tier shows that have grown in size and sort of followed the, you know, the Wizard model and the New York Comic Con model of having all these celebrity appearances, as you just said, for every guest that you book, for the big name guests, there is a certain amount of money that they have to walk out of that place with for the weekend.
Correct.
And if I'm not mistaken, if they don't make that money through whatever photo ops or table, you know, appearance stuff that they have, then the promoter is on the hook for making up the difference.
That is exactly right, sir. And that's a scary position to be in unless you're a millionaire.
Right.
But if you're like an average Joe like me, I pay for these things out of my own pocket. So that's why you won't see Harrison Ford at my show as much as I'd love to have him or somebody of that, you know, Robert Downey Jr., because I don't have $2 million to put out there. But the people that I can bring in have been top notch and they have created experiences that people talk about. And I love to read the comments or have people come up to me and say, I met John Wesley Shipp. Okay, John Wesley Shipp isn't Chris Evans, but you know what? He sat there, he talked to my kid, he talked to me, he took a photo with us, he remembered my name, we saw him again, he said hello. that's the type of interaction that has always been part of the shows that I produce and is part of TerrifiCon's motto. I'm never going to go away from that, because if you suddenly see me with stalls of actors like they do at the, you know, the massive shows like in New York or in Philadelphia, and there's 30, 40,000 people, that's great. But it's not that fun to stand, to me anyway, to me, because I've done this. I've gotten in line to go meet Chris Evans. I've gotten in line to meet Haley Atwell. You're there for a second, but that's just the reality of it. You're not going to have a 5-minute conversation with her, because they're not going to make the money back if you have a 5-minute conversation with her, because she needs to make X amount of money and you just have to do the math.
Right. It's by design that they cannot interact with you as much as they would like to. But I don't want to move off of John Wesley's ship just yet, because I have a great, I think that one of the things that I have talked about when we talk about the shows that you've put on is the type of guests that you bring to the show. And one of the things that I love about the guests that you bring to your shows is there is a, there's a certain level of character that someone sort of has in order to be a guest at your shows. And they are people who are going to interact with the fans, people who are going to make sure that people leave with a positive experience.
Yep.
And they will think better of that person after they meet them. And it was a couple years ago that and John Wesley Shipp has been a frequent guest at your shows.
Yeah, three times, almost four.
So the second time that he was there, this was a couple of years ago, I had taken my son, Parker, who was probably nine at the time, eight going on nine, and we had just lost our family dog of 7 years, very, very tragically, very, it was a very rough time for us. Days earlier, this happened. Well, we had gone to that show because, obviously, Matt and I were supposed to be there for Secret Identity, but Parker really wanted to meet John Wesley Shipp because he and I are huge Flash fans, and of course, me being a Flash fan from back in the day as well. And we went to that show, and he was so gracious.
Yeah, he's great.
He was so kind to my son. And he didn't know that any of that was going on with us. But just his general demeanor and his general way of interacting with people left such an impression on my son that it was really a very positive moment in a very difficult time for us. And so going back this year to TerrifiCon and being able to see John Wesley Shipp and catch up with him and have him see my son again and us talk about our new dog, you know, because we had waited an entire year before we got a new dog because it was just really difficult for the family to sort of transition, as you were well aware of.
I'm very well aware.
To have that moment again really just solidified for me and for my son what an amazing person that John Wesley Shipp is and what a fantastic memory that we have at the show. Now, we walked 10 feet over. Yeah. And we met Katrina Law for the first time.
Oh, she was a sweetheart. Show. Yeah.
And I'll have to post one of the pictures that we took with her when I put this interview up, because she was not only one of the nicest people that I've run into in a long time, but was having fun.
Yeah.
With all of the people that came by, she had, she was playing around with my son. She was super nice. We walked away from hanging, and she was taking time to make sure that everybody that came by the table had that connection, as opposed to it being sort of the treadmill,
the or factory, the sort assembly, of assembly line.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And so, you know, here we are walking away from a couple years of TerrifiCon with these lifelong memories of having met these amazing people. And that, to me, speaks to the level of, I mean, Tony Todd, Sam Jones, who plays Flash Gordon, like the people that have come in as guests for TerrifiCon over the years, really not only beloved people, but just quality people. And that I think means a real lot to the people that keep coming back every year.
No. And I love to hear that stuff, because it means I'm actually picking them right, because you don't know. You never know how it's going to go until it happens. Then you go, oh, wow, this guy was really good. Because Tony Todd was a last-minute addition, just to talk about him really quick. I've known him from Star Trek. I'm not a big horror movie fan like yourself, but I knew him as Worf's brother and just his voice, especially when he was the voice of was Zoom. Was it Zoom?
Yeah, it was Zoom.
Yeah. On The Flash. So I just knew that growly voice of his. The guy is the world's biggest teddy bear. I mean, he's got to be 6'6", 6'7". He's huge. He's a big, tall dude. But you see him, this imposing figure, but then you go up to him, how are you? And he grabs you and slaps you on the back, and he's from Connecticut, and he talked about Hartford and growing up and being in the Scouts. And he, Boy Scouts, it was amazing because you just don't see this. And he had somebody come up to him that went to grammar school with him and had a photo of a play that they did back in like third grade or something. And he went on and talked to that woman for like 20 minutes and how are you doing? And unbelievable. And it's just the nicest thing because, like I said, I don't really know a lot about his career besides the Star Trek stuff. But I went back and I went to go watch Candyman now because now I'm a fan of his, you know, more than I thought I was going to be.
Sure.
And it's so cool to see that because everybody walks around with different stories. You have your Ship and your Katrina Law. I've got people with Tony Todd stories and Michael Cudlitz and Cameron Bicondova from Gotham. She was dancing with people. And it's just nice to do a show like that. And the second we stop doing that type of show and we become a factory, then you could just tap me on the shoulder and say, okay, Mitch, throw the towel in because it's time to go home. Because I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be in the corner just, you know, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up.
Right. And we just spent, you know, probably 10 minutes or so talking about the celebrities that you've brought into that show. But the focus has always been
on artists.
The comics and the artists.
Yes.
And you had some just – what I love about the TerrifiCon shows is that there's these themes every year.
There
right?
is. So there are Spider-Man last year.
Exactly. A few years ago, we were able to do a panel on the Clone Saga, right?
Yep.
Which, you know, as a Spider-Man fan is just so – awesome for me to be a part of and talking to these creators. And then this year we had Roger Stern and J.M. DeMatteis and Peter David and Dan Slott all on a panel together talking about 35 years of writing Spider-Man, which to me is like dream come true. That's
right.
A Mount Rushmore for me of Spider-Man creators. But you have a great mix of veteran creators, you have a great mix of new creators, you have a great mix of indie creators. And then to go back to your story earlier about coming home with an armful of books, one of the things that we don't see enough of at shows today are vendors who are selling the 25-cent books, the dollar books, so that you can come in and you can actually fill out those holes in the collection. You talk about, you know, having your sheet of these are all the issues I need. I did that with my Marvel 2099 universe, where I had specific issues that I needed to finish out my collection. And to have vendors who have toys that are affordable and comics that are affordable is so important because, again, it's all part of the experience. You want somebody to walk out having met some of their favorite creators, having met some of their favorite celebrities, and having gotten some stuff that will round out their collection. And it's all part of the same experience. So I feel like with TerrifiCon, that balance is perfectly struck right now. Like this past year was just the absolute sweet spot.
Well, the thing of it is because being a fanboy for 45 years, this is my opportunity. It's kind of like I call it my living long box.
Yes, like your bucket list, right?
Yeah, it is. It's like I love the Kraven, the Last Hunt. Wait, I can get DeMatteis and Zek. And the inker was McLeod, maybe, or John Beattie. Oh, my God, they're here. And to them, they're just like, hey, how you doing? I'm like, they're the living personification of the Secret Wars, the Spider-Man run, the Fool Killer. And they're right in front of you. And to them, it's like, yeah, that's one of many of the books I've written. But it meant so much to me as a fan to have them there. And then you can do the question like, oh, what was it like? What was this? What was that? So it's fun to be a total nerd and enjoy it and know you're not going to get ridiculed for it. And even the people at New York Comic Con, I know some of the people that put together the Artist Alley there, they go, they're jealous of my show because I bring in creators that they normally wouldn't get because they're more of the, you know, let's get the superstars, the top 10, where I get the classic guys, the old timers. So there is that.
Well, and not only that, but you have this, like I said, theme going into each show. So you have these collections of creators that have worked on a particular project or particular books together. And so fans of that run or that collection or that event that happened so many years can come and hear panels and, you know, and go and meet with those guys and stuff like that. And that to me is what makes it so fun. But to go back to the promoter side of it, you know, we talked about the budgets of each, what you have to pay for each guest to get them to come in. It's different for every guest that you have. When you're talking about the celebrities, a lot of them do have that guarantee. So as a promoter, you're sort of building this house of cards, right? And you have this limited pool of money to put together what you hope is going to be an experience that has a little bit of something for everyone.
Yes.
And has a good balance of you know, guests that you think are going to be able to make their money back, and so that you're not going to be coming out of pocket for programming that is going to keep people at the venue over the course of the weekend,
you know,
milling about and coming in and out, and just that whole house of cards. It's so easy for it to go wrong, and we've been to plenty of shows where it goes wrong. You know, just seeing you over the course of a weekend, when I, you know, because Matt and I like to get there early, we like to set up before the doors open and stuff like that. But you know, you're running around 5 hours before we get there, and you know, making sure this person got in okay and this person knows where their panel is. One of the things I absolutely love is the fact that you have the Boy Scouts that help run, you know, get people to panels and make sure that people have what they need and make sure that the guests and the creators have water and stuff like that at their tables. That's really cool. But that whole thing, a lot of fans don't necessarily understand or appreciate the house of cards that it really is, especially when you're the guy running it. Like, this is not Reed Pop. This is not, you know, this army of, although you do have a wonderful group of people that help you put the show together every year, but
most of
this
them
is
are
you 24/7. Right, exactly. This is you 24/7 that is promoting, planning for next year, keeping that house of cards from falling over, and adjusting on the fly when things don't necessarily go as planned over the course of a given event. And I don't know that people understand just how much of a, you talked about spinning plates earlier before we started recording, how many plates you're actually spinning leading up to and going through a particular event, because it's just constant chaos.
Well, I do appreciate that. And I think the average bet that people have every year is, when do I lose my voice? And you can attest to that, because you'll see me Friday, you can hear me. By Sunday, I'm a whisper.
Oh, yeah. By Sunday morning, it's gone.
Yeah, because I'm over there, you know, you're not shouting. I'm not General Patton, but it's just that you don't stop talking over the crowd, because there's so many people there. The noise level just rises, so you have to rise with it. And before you know it, you can't talk anymore because you're just nonstop all day. And some people might think that's a blessing when they hear that I can't talk. But the other thing is, you're right. It is. You know what? I think it's because I did a lot of community stuff when the kids were little, like Little League. And I was involved with the kids' father's club at the school. We would raise money and we would do like backyard carnivals and we'd do events for Halloween and Christmas plays and all that stuff. And you go to the church or you try to do all these fundraisers. And the thing is about volunteering, I've learned a long time ago, you might get 100 people that said they'll help you, but the day of the event, 10 people show up.
Exactly.
So you have to plan for everything. So that's a lot of it that goes into it, is because, yeah, I do keep it close to the chest and I don't share or delegate too much, because I know if that guy doesn't show up, that's a problem. So I tend to do it a lot myself, and I might complain about it, and my wife will tell you, he doesn't stop talking about it. But when you're personally invested, not only financially but emotionally and physically, because I want this show to be so successful that, you know, it's one of those things, you're like on a team, you can't let the team down, and the team is all you guys. And it's the fans, it's the creators, it's the guests, it's the dealers, it's the exhibitors. And I might be nuts to think this way, but I think I owe all you guys something for showing up and giving up your weekend and being there. And yeah, financially, I get the rewards if the show's successful. There's a lot of tickets sold that helps pay my kids' college. That's great. That's the fringe benefit of it all. But I got to make sure I put on a heck of a party for you. And that's really what it comes down to. It's like, you're coming to my house. I'm having a big barbecue that weekend.
Right.
I got the rock band. I got everything. But I got to make sure everything is top notch, so you coming back next year. And when you leave, you tell your friends, hey, dude, that was a great party he had. You got to go next year.
Right. Especially because you know that there are so many parties
being thrown
across the country. Yep.
Street.
Absolutely.
Yes,
not
sir.
Just in New England, but all across the country and even all around the world now. Like the convention game, and we could do a whole other show just about the sort of landscape of convention promoting and organizing and how it's changed over the past several years.
Yeah.
But you're absolutely right. You have to not only provide a great experience for this year, but you have to have people leave there already committing to, I'm coming back next year. This show was too good.
Yeah, and that's what, and I've seen what's happened to a lot of shows and what they've evolved into, good or bad, but I'm trying to stick to that path, and that's why this year's guest list is bigger than last year's guest list when it comes to comic book creators, because I've got a laundry list of people we haven't even had at the show yet, because I can't get everybody at once. You can't get everything you need. So every year I'm adding more and more to that, my checkoff list. Like, oh, I got him, got that guy, got this one. It's almost like I'm going around with a list now collecting people.
But I also think that you have established something which Matt and I talk a lot about, sort of the reputation of Secret Identity, if you will, or the legacy of Secret Identity, where, you know, we go to a show, big or small, and if there's anybody there that has ever known us, you know, if we go around in Artist Alley and we're asking someone, hey, would you like to do an interview for the show? Inevitably, there's somebody a table or two over that says, oh, yeah, you can talk to those guys. They're cool. Yeah. You know, they're not going to ambush you. They're just there to help celebrate your stuff, and they're good guys. And I think that as every year goes by and TerrifiCon solidifies this reputation of a very fan-friendly convention, a very creator-friendly convention, mm-hmm. a lot of fun, more and more guests want to come to that show. More and more guests thinking about how it would make sense for them to fit it in their schedule to be at your show next year.
It's been easier to get guests as the years go on. And it's because exactly what you just said, because I bring in, we did the Death of Superman panel. And I, because my friend Jerry Ordway is friends with all these guys that worked on Death of Superman and women. So we called up Louise Simonson. We called up Dan Juergens. We called up Mike Carlin, who was the editor. We called up John Bogdanov. A lot of these folks haven't seen each other in years.
Sure.
The, you know, the way the world works and life takes you here and there, and they move to California with D.C. or something. So they get together, and it's like a high school reunion, and they haven't seen it. They're swapping stories. And so they walk away with a tremendous experience and a fun time, and they want to come back. Like Walt Simon's saying, hey, come on, anytime you want me to come back, because he liked having 3 days with his old friends to sit there and swap war stories with. And then go out and have a nice, you know, Italian dinner or beer or something. And the fringe benefit is that if they're happy, that exudes out of them and it radiates. So when the fans come up to them, hey, how are you? You know, so they're happy there. They're having a good time. The fans are having a great experience. And everybody's walking away cool. Everybody's saying this was really fun. And I'm literally getting email requests from people without me asking nowadays, and not to toot my own horn, but it's amazing to see, hey, I heard your show was great, so-and-so, or yep. whoever. And I'm like, are you kidding me? I never thought I'd be talking to this guy, let alone him calling me by first name, asking if he can get a table because he wants to go, you know, meet his old buddies and stuff. So that's always part of the secret to the success. And I've modeled my show, I think you were with us, Matt, our friend Steve Barker, and our friend Billy went to the Baltimore Comic Con
yep.
in 2010. And Matty said, do you want to come with us? I said, sure. To me, that is the best Comic Con there as a comic book fan. I'm not getting into celebrities.
Sure.
I'm not getting into movie actors and all that. But for pure comic books, that model was amazing to me. I was floored. It was wall-to-wall comic book dealers. There wasn't a Funko Pop in sight back then. And I'm like, this is amazing. You can go crazy. It's like a kid in a candy store. And all the creators were there. Todd McFarlane was there, and they were all cool. You know, they was like, this is the locker room. You got behind the scenes, and they weren't, you know, big heads about it. And I'm talking to Adam Hughes 1 second. There's Jim Starlin right next to him. I'm like, this is amazing to me. And they're fans of each other, too. So you get to watch. Even at my show, I saw Steve Epting last year shaking as he met Garcia Lopez. Because he grew up wanting to be Garcia Lopez. That was his role model. He would try to draw like Jose Luis Garcia Lopez.
Right.
And he got a sketch, just like you and I would get in line. He got a sketch of Batman from Garcia Lopez, and he was literally shaking, and he was showing me like our friend Steve shows sketches when he gets them at shows because he's a fan. He goes, can you believe this? Garcia Lopez drew this for me. And I'm looking at him going, yeah, but you're Steve Epting, dude. You drew the Captain America and the Winter Soldier. You're just as good as a – no, that's him. So it's fun to watch their reaction as well, to know that they're fans and they're enjoying the experience at the show too. But, you know, we can go on about this all day.
Right.
I love TerrifiCon. It's the best job I ever had, and I love doing this, and I don't mind getting up at 4 in the morning to go to the local radio station to talk about comic books. And then that night – go to a Cub Scout meeting across town because they want to talk about comics. So I went from radio DJs, shock jocks in the morning to at night talking to a room of 36-year-olds to 10-year-olds about where's Gotham City and how come Spider-Man doesn't meet Superman. And I'm having the time of my life. And then I come home and I start working on the website and doing the graphics and, you know, making airline flights for people to come out here. So in a nutshell, It's the greatest job in the world.
Well, and people can go to TerrifiCon.com, which I'll put a link to in the show notes, but that is happening August 18th through the 20th this year at Mohegan Sun. And that is a good segue into the other convention that is happening earlier this year at the Mohegan Sun, because this blew me away. When we came to TerrifiCon this year, and we had talked a little bit about it ahead of time, but that's when I started seeing the banners and the advertising for Connecticut GamerCon, which is happening April 1st and 2nd of this year at that same venue, at Mohegan Sun. You are now putting on a gaming convention. Tell me how that spun out of TerrifiCon.
Well, as a comic book fan, a video game fan, and a rock and roll fan, and a horror movie, you know all these are interconnected.
Absolutely.
They're all linked together. And as a kid, I grew up in the 70s, so we didn't have, you know, Xbox or PlayStation. We had primitive stuff. We had 2600s. We had 8-bit heroes that we envisioned were really Captain America or Superman, even though they didn't look like much more than a bunch of little blue squares on the wall. So let me just tell you, just from doing this, I thought comic book fans were passionate because I grew up as one. Gaming fans take it to the umpteenth degree. I don't even know how to describe it. They're so focused, more so than comic book fans. I never imagined, because I would be an occasional gamer. I would play my Atari, my ColecoVision. I had my Sega Genesis. I still have it downstairs in the basement. So it was fun to play the superhero. The X-Men game is Sega Genesis. To this day, I still have it. I've never beaten the Savage Land level. I can't stop thinking about that.
Yeah.
But when I was doing the shows, I noticed people coming up to me and I'm like, hey, do you have any video game stuff? Do you have any gaming rooms? I'm like, oh, okay, we'll do that. So last year we finally did it. And that room was nonstop busy. I walked by it every time and there was people waiting to go play Mario Brothers or Mario Kart or you name it. And I'm like, this is really successful. So much so that my own sons, who are not into comics anymore, they're into sports or whatever, are lining up because they want to go play Rocket League upstairs or they want to go play FIFA. And I'm like, geez, this is really something. And every year I take my son to PAX up in Boston, PAX East. And it's like concert tickets. When they go on sale, and you know this too, you have to be right at your computer because if you don't, it's going to sell out and you're not going to be able to go.
As someone who has not been able to go because of how fast they sell out, I can attest to that, yes.
So I went there with my son, Owen, and he said, Dad, we got to go to PAX. We got to go to PAX. And he literally, it's like a rock concert for him. So I would get the tickets, and we'd go there. And I was like, this is a Comic-Con, except the focus isn't on comic books and movies. It's on video games and tabletop gaming and all that. And this is what it is. It's just literally a Comic-Con for games. And there's cosplayers, and there's classic arcade games. And the appeal, like I said, is just as passionate, just as strong. So I said, well, why can't we just go to something like that here in Connecticut? There's Kineticon, which I've taken him to, and it's a great show, and there's a lot of anime and stuff like that. But that was almost overwhelming. It was almost too big, because Kineticon is spread out. If you've ever gone to it, and you know that too.
Yes.
They have hotels off-site where they have video game competitions going on there, or they have anime festivals there, and then you go to the convention center where the cosplay is. It's all over Hartford. It's amazing. But when you're like 12 or 13 or 14, it's almost too much. So, you know, I could see it in their eyes. They were getting like overwhelmed by it. They couldn't take it all in. So I said, why don't I just do a smaller scale version of PAX? And I mentioned it to Mohegan Sun, and they've been very happy with the attendance at the TerrifiCon.
Yep.
So they said, sure, you want to do another event, we'll work with you. And they actually are more interested in the video game convention than they are with the Comic-Con, because you know this too, competitive esports has taken off in the last couple of years. There's TV shows on Friday night and Saturday on ESPN, on TBS, where you can watch people video game for hours. And then you have Twitch, where you watch people play games and stuff. And I'm like, this is amazing. It's a whole other culture out there. So they were like, yeah, let's tap into this. Let's bring that crowd in here, because we see that there's a want for it. So why not satisfy that? And if you want to do your event here, you're more than welcome. So the origins to GamerCon have really lied in the Comic-Con. It was always there. And then I just took that one segment of that show and just expanded it to, so this April 1st and 2nd, we're going to have Connecticut's Terrific GamerCon, or CT GamerCon. And everybody has envisions of what they think this is going to be. So I really have a lot to live up to, even yourself, because I'll call you or email you and say, Brian, what's this about Dungeons and Dragons? What's this about this tabletop? How big is this thing? There's so many games out there. It's been overwhelming.
Well, and yeah, I mean, and the other thing too is that in terms of conventions, like the reason that PAX is so huge, and you know, there's always been Gen Con, which is more of a tabletop focus. There's always been Origins. There's always been Dragon Con. But in terms of like video game conventions, they're not anywhere near as prolific as comic book conventions. And so I feel like there absolutely is a place for a show like this in Connecticut. And as much as I love comic books, and obviously I've been podcasting about them for 11 years now, gaming is much more of a passion of mine than comic books. I grew up, as you mentioned, you know, I'm a few years behind you, but I'm in my 40s. I grew up with the Atari 2600. Yeah. I grew up with the NES, and I grew up on the red box of Dungeons and Dragons that I, you know, bought for $10 off of a kid's older brother when I was in Catholic school in like fifth grade. And those have been lifelong passions for me. My own writing, my own fiction writing is heavily influenced by, you know, a lot of that stuff. And back in around 2008 through 2010, I was covering games for comic book resources. Like I wanted to be a games, I wanted to dabble in games journalism. I have a website, Co-op Critics, where we do a podcast about games and YouTube videos about games and stuff like that. My son and I, a couple of weekends ago, just built his first PC together.
I saw that, which was super fun. I saw that.
So, and you're absolutely right. The passion that people have for games is akin to the passion that, you know, fans of comic books have for comic books. And there are sort of, I don't want to say they're two different audiences, but you're absolutely right in that the competitive gaming scene has really exploded over the past decade, for sure, to the point, and a lot of that is because of the accessibility of Twitch and YouTube. And now you mentioned, you know, we're seeing some of these events on ESPN. The mainstream focus on it and the accessibility to see videos of it is just more than it ever has been before. Even the consoles now have the built-in ability to stream gaming and stuff like that.
And
you noticed when they advertised the Nintendo Switch, when Nintendo was put out the first trailer for their new Nintendo Switch, a part of that trailer was dedicated to showing a group of players playing Splatoon at a Coliseum full of people at a competitive sports event.
See.
Now, whether or not that's actually going to happen with that particular game and that particular console, in the very first introduction trailer for that console, they showed esports. And so that is absolutely... So you have people who are into the competitive side of gaming, and then you have people who are into the casual and everywhere in between. And so with all the different consoles and all the different platforms, with mobile, with PC, with console, you know, there's so many different facets to gaming.
Yes.
And that's just on the video gaming side, because I'm also, you know, a huge fan of tabletop gaming. And so, you know, there is a lot of crossover between those two audiences, but I'm excited to see the gaming audience of this area that we live in show up for Connecticut GamerCon.
Well, the thing of it is, too, it's penetrated, just like the comic books have become mainstream now. Like when you and I grew up, you could barely find a Superman logo on a T-shirt. It was hard to find such a thing. It didn't exist. And now you can walk into Dick's Sporting Goods, you can walk into Target, Walmart. I could go out now and buy a whole wardrobe of superhero-related merchandise and T-shirts and clothing because it's acceptable. I knew the video game stuff was big because, like I said, I had kids. But then you realize that the kids get older and you start to hear that there's people taking whole days off of work when there's a new release of Call of Duty just because they want to play it the second it comes out, and they have the midnight releases. And there's people lined up to get that game because they want to play as soon as they unwrap it, you know? And then I went to Buffalo Wild Wings, and Titanfall 2 is being promoted on all the wrappers and the napkins at Buffalo Wild Wings, which is a place you think of, oh, that's where I'm going to go and have some beer and some wings with my buddies and watch the football game, you know?
Right.
Because there's that competitive edge, and then the whole thing with fantasy football that's become mainstream, which you and I both know is really just Dungeons and Dragons. Except it's not with wizards, it's with quarterbacks.
Oh, absolutely.
And but that's okay, though. I mean, my son's playing, you know, fantasy football because that's cool. But I'm like, you do realize this whole adding up the points and doing this and doing that is based on a TSR module came out in 1983. But it's cool. So the whole video game stuff has become so accepted. When I mentioned GamerCon, the response to GamerCon has been bigger than Comic-Con, and it's from all ages. I've had like guys at the loading dock, like, I can't wait to your GamerCon comes here at Mohegan Sun. And this is back in August.
Right.
And I hadn't even started planning it yet. But they all have this notion, the thought that they could play games and be with, again, that community experience. You're like, wait a second, you could go home now, put your headset on, and play online. What are you talking about? But it's a silo. You're not with people. You're not engaging. You're not seeing the reaction. You're hearing it through your headphones, which is fantastic. But there's a whole other level to being side by side with your buddies or another guy you've never met and you're playing competitively. And it's just as fierce as baseball or real sports where you're out there playing soccer because the competitive spirit just comes out of you naturally and you want to win. And it's just something to watch. And that's what people do. They come to watch the stuff. So when you come to Connecticut Gamer Con in April, we're going to have movie screens set up. So you're going to watch the two guys battle each other out. And there's going to be like 300 chairs set up like a theater where you could sit down and watch the main event. Like you're watching Tyson versus Holyfield or something like that. And it, to me, 20 years ago, if you told me people would get in line and come to an auditorium to watch people play video games, I'm like, are you kidding me? That's the worst part of a video game, is standing over someone's shoulder waiting for them to get killed so you could play. But now, people, like you said, Twitch is just made up of people watching games. I mean, it's mind-blowing to me how the world has changed. It seems so fast, but it has been coming for the last 10 years or so. But there's whole channels dedicated to this stuff, Brian. It's just amazing. So when we do this April 1st and 2nd, it's baby steps. Everybody wants this and wants that. So I'm trying to satisfy everybody's needs, and we'll see. And you live and learn. So maybe this year we do so much on Magic the Gathering, we do a little D&D. Sure. Next year we realize, oh, D&D was bigger than Magic. Let's do more of that. So it's an evolving process. And who knows, if it's so successful, Mohegan's like, why do you have to do it every year? Why can't you do it like twice a year or once a quarter?
Well, and that's the thing. The first year for any show is an experiment, right? And so, you know, in some of the people listening to this who are hardcore gamers are listening and realizing that this is a lot of new ground for you because you are a comic book fan first and a gamer a very distant second. And so, but even looking at, because the show is still, the guests are coming together, the events are and programming are still coming together right now, but things that are already available, if you go to ctgamercon.com, you can sign up for the tournaments. And they're run by Game Underground, and you have Super Smash Brothers Melee, you have Street Fighter V, you have Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3, and those are just some of the things that are available right now. So people can go and sign up if they want to take part in the tournaments, the cash prize tournaments that are happening at the show. And then on top of that, there will be tabletop gaming and there will be retro gaming. And that's not even speaking of the vendors. Like, one of the coolest things for me as someone who has grown up with games is to go and buy, you know, because I have retro consoles and things like that, is to go and buy an old Atari game that I want to add to my collection, or I want to go and buy an old NES game or SNES game to add to my collection, or maybe a, you know, a Game Boy that somebody's refurbished and customized or something like that. Like, I get excited for the game vendors that are going to be at the show because that's all nostalgia for me. It's the same thing with D&D books. Like, I have shelves and shelves of everything from the original Red Box set all the way through the orange-spined AD&D books and 2nd edition and 3rd edition and 4th edition and 5th edition of D&D and all these other role-playing games. And so I like just going and flipping through all the game books that they have at different vendors. And I know that there will be some crossover between some of the vendors that have been at your comic show and some of the ones that are going to be coming to GamerCon, because they serve both of those audiences as well.
Yeah, like you said, the crossover is there, but it breaks out and goes in different avenues I never expected before, because there's superhero. See, now my eyes light up because there's Injustice and there's you know, superhero gaming and Capcom and X-Men. So I'm like, oh my God, this Magneto, now you're talking my language, you know, so I get into it too.
Right, and we're getting new installments of both of those games upcoming. But another great thing is that this show is happening literally weeks after the launch of the new Nintendo console.
And Nintendo will be there on Sunday. They called me a week ago and they said, would you mind? I love that. Would you mind if we came and set up for a couple hours and talked about our new Switch system? I'm like,
right. Would I mind?
Because I'm like, I was trying to ask you guys and they called me. And because why? they saw one of my postcards at a GameStop, because I drive around, once again, going back to like doing everything yourself. Johnny Appleseed here. I drive around. My car is loaded with flyers for comic conventions and gaming conventions. And I stop at every gas station, diner, GameStop, you name it, a library. Hey, can I put one of these flyers out here? Because you never know where you're going to see somebody or somebody's going to hear about you. And this guy from Nintendo, the sales rep, was at a GameStop in Hartford, saw the postcard, calls me up and goes, hey, I didn't know there was a Connecticut GamerCon. I go, well, it's the first one we're ever going to do at Mohegan Sun. And he goes, do you mind if we show up? And not only that, Brian, but I'm going to be giving away a Switch on Sunday.
That is awesome, because I can tell you that not everybody who wants a Switch is going to be able to get a Switch when they launch. I pre-ordered mine the day that they went up for pre-order.
But, I did too.
But you're going to have – the cool thing is you're going to have people who have gotten theirs, because it's a very mobile console. You're going to have people bringing them there. You're going to have people games against each other there. You're going to have people who want to learn more about it because they haven't even had a chance to put hands on it yet. And so it's kind of awesome that the very first – Connecticut GamerCon is happening right after the launch of a major console, because it kind of
on the eve
is
of it,
part of
yeah.
that vibe now, and that's really exciting for me. So
yeah.
I'm so excited for the show. This is, you know, we go to so many shows that are comic focused, and I love comics, and you know, Matt is, of the two of us, the lifelong comic historian and fan.
Yes, he is.
Gaming is my thing, and I am super, super excited, especially because I haven't done any shows as Co-op Critics.
Mm-hmm.
Like Co-op Critics is the YouTube channel and the website that we have, and we've been doing this for a few years now.
Yeah.
It was basically something that spun out of my time in game journalism. And so most of the time when we go to shows, though, it's Secret Identity. And so this is actually a show where I actually got a banner for Co-op Critics to bring. And my son, who is much more of a gamer than a comic book fan, is super excited for that show. So, I mean, it's – and I love the first year – of any show, because as we talked about,
that's
it is
a learning,
an experiment.
Yeah.
It is figuring out what the audience is in this geographic area.
Mm-hmm.
What do people want to see? What are people into? And when you throw in the release of a new console in that, to me, that's just the ingredients for a super interesting weekend, a super fun weekend, and hopefully we will get a humongous turnout at that show and build a lot of great relationships that we can carry into next year.
And what I'm going to say is too, is just like you said, it is a learning curve, and I'm open to suggestions like you wouldn't believe, because we have music coming, because I said there's video game bands. I did not realize that. Sure enough, there's people coming. I even called you up. I said, well, Power Glove isn't coming because they had another date in New York, but we were trying to get them. But I go, Brian, do you know who Power Glove is? You go, well, Power Glove is based on the Nintendo accessory, but there's also a band and they've done the music to these video games. So I go, oh, so you've heard of these people.
The thing I love about getting emails from you about Connecticut GamerCon is like once a week you'll be like,
they're all
hey,
over.
What do you think about this? And I'll be like, holy crap, that person, or holy crap, that thing, that's amazing. And that's it's super exciting to see sort of the show coming together.
Yeah.
But also knowing that it's a first year show and there will be a lot to be learned at this first year show. Can't wait to – I just can't wait to see the gaming community come out, because you mentioned PAX East – and how it sells out almost immediately. PAX East happens in Boston. That is with those larger shows, same thing with New York Comic Con, between the amount of money that are spent on exhibitors and, you know, the cost of living in those particular areas when those shows,
yeah,
like, not only do the tickets go immediately, but people get priced out of those events very quickly. There's a lot of people that can't afford, I would put myself in that can't afford to go and get a hotel room in Boston for the weekend and go to PAX East or something like that, even though I would absolutely love to. It's like that. So to have this show happening at Mohegan, which is a great place and it has an amazing hotel and it is a fantastic convention space and it has plenty of space for people to hang out and game together, to hang out and talk together, to spend time together, you know, and it can never be understated that parking is free at Mohegan Sun.
Yeah, free parking. And even the admission price, I'm only charging $15 because it's the first year. And I'm like, yeah, why? Look, I don't know what you guys, because I know PAX, I bought the tickets for my son. I think they were 40-something for Sunday, 40-something each.
For one day.
For one day, yeah. And I said, you know what?
And you and I both know that Sundays are often a day where half the guests aren't there.
I know.
Because the guests come in for Saturday, and they come in for one day, and then they fly out.
Well, that's why Saturdays sold out in hours. I got the call that they were on sale at noon on a Wednesday, and by the time I'd managed to get in front of a screen to buy the tickets, they were gone. And it was only like 2 or 3 hours later. So he came home from school. I said, I got PAX tickets. Did you get Saturday? I said, no, all I had could get Sunday. And you can see his face. I'm like, but what do you want me to do? They sold out so quickly. So that's why when I did this show, I said, look, not everybody gets to go to PAX. So maybe they can come here. And because I know it's not on the same scale yet as PAX, I can't charge tons of money. So let's just do $15 with free parking. And like you said, there's plenty of rooms I have upstairs, open conference rooms. If you want to bring your folder full of magic cards or Yu-Gi-Oh or Pokemon or just want to hang out. I had a guy call me the other day and said, can we buy some tables from you to set up an Overwatch tournament? I said, well, I wasn't going to do Overwatch this year, but if you want to do it. So they're putting money together out of their own pocket to buy a table just to set up with their laptops. And again, this is the thing about community.
And that's a smart move because Overwatch is humongous now.
Oh, it's huge. Oh, I know. My son plays League of Legends and Overwatch. It's all I hear about.
Yes, I'm a big Overwatch fan and player.
But that's the thing, though. I was like, there's not a facility big enough that can get a room for every particular fan of every game because there's so many. Here's an example. Are you going to have war?
I'm also just going to point out really quick that it's Yu-Gi-Oh!
Yu-Gi-Oh!
Because
what do I say?
A million people will comment Yu-Gi-Oh! You know how it
that's
goes.
That's my Connecticut accent. Okay, that's my Connecticut
New there
York.
It is. That's what it was.
Yeah,
it
Yu-Gi-Oh! Was. Let's say Yu-Gi-Oh! Potato.
I kind of like that better.
Okay. It's one of those things you see written, but you don't pronounce enough. Like there's plenty of words in comic books that I've always been amazed. Like I always say Magneto when I was a kid, and then people don't know it's Magneto. Uh-huh. I'm like, where do you get that from? And it just goes on about that. Okay. But we diverge. We divulged. We go off on a tangent on this stuff. But the other thing is, like I said, I got folks calling me up. Are you going to have Warhammer there? I'm like, okay, but don't you need to bring your own customized tables for that? Yes, you do. Well, how are we going to do that? Well, are you going to have Dungeons and Dragons? Yes. But are you also going to have Pathfinder? I don't know. Are you going to have the X-Wing Final Flight or Fantasy Flight? The folks that make
From Fantasy Flight Games. Yep, they're a publisher.
Yeah, and then are you going to have the Munchkins? You know, the little card game that you get from Stephen Anderson
games.
Yeah, there's so many of them. I'm like, look, we're going to try to do something for everybody the first year out, and then
isn't that amazing? Because what I think what that immediately tells you is like. People have heard that you're putting on a gaming show, and they're like, holy crap, please tell me that my favorite game is going to be there.
Yeah, yeah. And I even put on the website, I said, if you have anything or suggestions you want to get in on the game, email me. And that's what's happened. I've had more people write to me like, can I set up, do this? Can I do that? And we have folks coming to do game demonstrations. Maybe you'll see a game that you've never played before, but the manufacturers are going to be there. Because that's the other thing, too. Just like you and I know how comic book conventions work with small-time publishers or indie publishers where they're trying to get their book out into the marketplace and get a bigger audience. I didn't realize it, stupid me, that that's how it works with a lot of game publishers. There's a lot of guys that make board games or card games that just want to have a platform to expose the game to potentially new fans.
Oh, absolutely.
And they look for this. But I didn't realize how big it was. I call up and they're like, hey, do you mind if I bring this game? I just came up with it. I'm like, sure, why not? And they're out there trying to pitch their stuff. And I've gone to gaming conventions since then to promote the show. And it's literally rooms full of every niche game you can imagine. There's a sushi chef and beer hunter.
Well, and just imagine now, so you have this independent developer, or you maybe have this team of two or three people that have developed a game for PC, and they're trying to get the word out about it, and then they try to go to a larger gaming convention.
And they can't afford it.
They can't afford to go exhibit, and not to mention, if they do, you and I both know from New York Comic Con, you can spend your money to buy a booth at New York Comic Con.
You get lost.
But you get lost amidst the noise. And so that's another thing about having a show, not only that is new, but one that is more reasonably sized, is that you have a lot more chance of connecting with a potential audience than you would when you're just drowned out by, the million other voices.
And the thing of it is, the reason why I hooked up with Game Underground is because exactly that reason. I went to PAX last year because my friend Laird, who you've met before, and he's come to some of the shows, he worked for Lucasfilm. He worked for Activision. He was one of the people that helped create Guitar Hero. And now he worked on Oculus, and he helped bring that to market. So I would go to PAX because he said, hey, come and check out our new Oculus headset, the virtual reality thing. So I went there for that. But the lines were tremendous, and thank God I knew him because we cut the line. And my son, I said, don't get used to this. This is not how the real world works. The real world is you wait in line for 2 hours like everybody else.
Right. Not everybody's dad is a promoter.
Yeah. Not everybody knows Uncle Laird, who's one of the CEOs of Oculus and such. So once we were there, I said, I can't wait in these lines because the booths were so great. And I felt bad for my kids because it's like you're going to Disney World and you want to go on Space Mountain, but the line's 10 hours long and you can't get in there. And they want to see all the new games and they want to try out all the new video games, but there's so much noise and so many people that I managed to go to the outskirts of PAX where you see the smaller vendors. And that's what I'm more used to. Like we have at the Comic-Con, like the guys that have the Funko Pops or the action figures and, you know, that type of flea market setup where you can go shop for things. So I'm walking around there and I see Game Underground and they're running some tournaments and they were more digestible. You know what I mean? It was, you could do it. You could sit down, you could play the game, you could talk to somebody. It was more intimate. I'm like, okay, if the whole PAX was like this, I wouldn't mind it. It's so noisy 5 feet away from here. I can't even hear what the guy's trying to tell me about. So that was the whole thing. I brought that whole intimacy from the TerrifiCon into GamerCon. So you're going to be able to play your video games. You're going to be able to hang out with your friends. You're going to be able to shop. But you're not going to lose your voice, okay? You're not going to have your ears bleeding because it's so loud in there. Because all the people are trying to scream over each other. Because PAX is great, but PAX is also overwhelming sometimes. And I just go, oh boy, I got to go outside and get some air.
Right.
So hopefully when people come to the first Connecticut GamerCon, they like it so much they tell their friends to come back next year. And we grow, but we also listen to what they want. And they go, could you just set up a small area in the corner so I can play Madden with my friends and we'll do this over here. And I'm like, sure, whatever you guys want. It's your show. You tell me. I'm the host. What do you want me to do next time? Or what do you want? Do you want more cosplay? Do you want more music? Do you want this? Do you want that?
Well, and that's the cool thing, too, is that people who are coming to this year's show really get a chance to impact what next year's show looks like.
And yeah,
so
yeah, exactly.
If you're listening to this and this sounds interesting to you, you can go to ctgamercon.com. Again, the show is happening on the 1st and 2nd of April 2017 at Mohegan Sun. $15 a day. Kids 8 and under are free.
Free.
It's going to go from 10 to 10 on Saturday and 10 to 5 on Sunday.
Correct.
So tournaments, panels of programming, vendors,
yeah,
everything under the sun, and as you just mentioned, the Nintendo Switch as well. So I could not be more excited for Connecticut GamerCon this year, and to have that as a complement event to TerrifiCon really, to me, sort of solidifies my con-going schedule for the year. Like, those are the two shows that I'm going to be planning around now, which is really exciting.
Well, you know what the plan is? If they expand the convention center at Mohegan, I was thinking one day, one side of the building, the comic convention, the other side, the gaming convention.
You know, I don't think that's a bad idea when the venue can handle that because when New York Comic Con did the New York Anime Festival as well for a couple years, they had it together. I felt like that was an idea that could have worked if they had planned it more appropriately.
Yeah, the anime got shoehorned upstairs. You didn't even know it existed. I'm like, there's an anime.
One year
show?
It was in the basement, and another year it was in another area. But had they put that together in a different way, I think
it
would have worked. And I absolutely think that you could have a because there's so much crossover between those two audiences. And what one of the cool things before we wrap up is that many of our favorite comic artists
I knew you were going to say that. Dan Slott, Dan Abnett.
Have started their careers in writing for either tabletop games. Many of them are currently video game writers in addition to doing work in comics as well. A lot of times if you go and look at, and the one I use as an example all the time is my buddy Anthony Johnston, who I do a heavy metal podcast with called Thrash It Out. He is a very well-known comic book writer. His book, The Coldest City, is going to be a movie that's coming out this year. And but he did a ton of work writing for the Dead Space series, which is one of the best horror series of all time in terms of video games. And so there's just a ton of Frank Thierry has worked on the Marvel versus Capcom series.
Yep, I know Frank.
Paul Miatti has worked on the Injustice series. Like, there's so much crossover between the comic creators that we know and the video game world. And for artists, it's 10 times more so. And so there is a ton of crossover there.
I believe Dan Abnett, who I know from comic books and Guardians of the Galaxy author and all that type of stuff, is huge with the Blizzard
folks. He's huge into Warhammer stuff, if I'm not mistaken. Warhammer, he's done a ton of Warhammer stuff.
Yeah, I know. And I found out because I was trying to get him to come to the Comic-Con, the TerrifiCon this year. And he unfortunately can't make it this August because of a family thing. But he was talking to me about the GamerCon. He's like, what's this that's on your website? I said, oh, I'm doing a new thing. He goes, you do know who I am, right? I said, yeah, you're Dan Abnett, Guardians of the Galaxy.
Right. And you're this, like, comic book guy.
No. Yeah. He's like, I am the guy that's writing all the characters. And I go, I didn't know that. And then Dan Slott, the same thing. Dan Slott wrote tons of, was it D&D?
I don't know if he did D&D or not, but I know he's been involved in some of the Spidey games. I think he Peter David has absolutely done video game work as well. And so there is a ton of crossover there. And from an artist standpoint, like, so many artists in comics also have done and still do art for gaming books. So when you look at the amazing interior art, when you open up a D&D book or a Pathfinder book or anything like that, you will see a lot of people who do crossover work between comics and between between those books as well. So to me, it's just two sides of the same coin.
Exactly. But if you didn't know the other side of the coin was there, it's all new to you. That's why my mind's blown. And Greg Capullo, who's coming to TerrifiCon this August from Batman, I know him from Batman and Spawn. He's also done a lot of work for video game stuff. So it is, you know what? It's right in front of us. Sometimes the greatest inventions are right in front of your face, just don't see them.
I, for one, cannot wait for Connecticut GamerCon. Of course, we'll be at TerrifiCon as well. But I appreciate you taking the beginning of your Saturday morning to talk about it. And this interview is going to go up both on Co-op Critics and on Secret Identity. And you can watch both of those spaces for more updates about programming, about tournaments, about games that are coming to Connecticut GamerCon over the next couple months, and hopefully we will see people there. I know I'll see you there, Mitch.
Oh, yeah, for at least a second as I run by going, I'm losing my voice. I have to go upstairs. There's a Bon Jovi concert there that night.
I know.
And they've already told me, they go, Bon Jovi, he likes gaming. I go, bring him on.
Not only that, dude, but so many of the longtime Bon Jovi fans who grew up in the 80s are going to be huge gamers as well. So I would not be surprised at all for you to get a lot of spillover from the people who are staying in the hotel that weekend to go to Bon Jovi, coming down to check out what's going on at Connecticut GamerCon. So there you go. But thanks again for your time. And, you know, we'll put links in the show notes to everything that we talked about today. And we'll keep you posted on what's happening at both of these shows in the next few months.
Thank you very much, Brian. I appreciate it as always. And I'll email you every day of the week anyway.
I look forward to it.
Voiceover guys. Do you want voiceover guys? What about programmers? What about developers? Right. You think this guy's good? What about this guy? So anyway, it's fun. But thanks again for doing this.
And thanks for coming on.